From the very first day I and everybody else heard about Asahi Linux, there were already naysayers. Oh, you're trying to get Linux running on the Apple silicon and Apple's not going to help you? Oh, you're never going to be able to boot a Linux kernel. Shit, wait, they can do that now. Well, you're never going to get networking functioning. Wait, they can do that. Well, you'll never get a desktop environment running. Okay? Will you never have working GPU drivers? You'll never be able to game on this system. How do we move the goalposts again? Every single step of the way, the project has pulled through. The project has overcome these barriers. And no, they're not supporting the hardware as quickly as Apple does. They don't have all of the internal Apple schematics. They don't have the Apple engineering team working on this hardware. But even so, for a reverse engineering project, they're doing a really good job. And obviously losing Hector Martin as the project lead is a big deal and is a big hit to the engineering effort of the project. But I think a lot of people fail to realize that, yes, Hector did do a lot of work in the project, but there have been other big names involved for quite a while now, and other major leaps have been done by these people. And one of those people involved in the project is Sven Peter. The other person involved in upstreaming Asahi Linux code into the kernel. Now, there is another person that did replace Hector, but Sven was there when Hector was involved as well. Anyway, this is what he had to say in regards to the upcoming, well, maybe not upcoming, but work in progress M4 support. M4, for anyone who doesn't know, is, as a recording, the current generation of Apple Silicon. Looks like M4 support for Asahi Linux is going to be rather painful. We're still focusing on upstreaming M1/M2 support, but other people have been trying to bring up M1/M1 on M4, and it looks like a few things have changed. Now, M1/N1, otherwise known as Mini, whatever you want to call it, it frankly doesn't really matter what you pronounce it as. This is the bootloader used on the Apple Silicon. Not the bootloader used by Apple, that's some proprietary internal thing, but the bootloader built by the Asahi Linux project. Now, as for the upstreaming story, it might seem like from what happened not that long ago that nothing ever gets upstreamed. Everything is just a disaster. Everything always falls apart. And in some ways, that is true because there are some parts of Asahi Linux which are very much tied up in the Rust support. And the Rust support in the kernel is this whole other nightmare that, you know, affects more than just Asahi Linux. But there are things actually being upstreamed, and they are happening at a relatively reasonable pace. Now, whilst I say that, it's still going to be a very, very long time away until you actually run Asahi Linux on an unmodified kernel. You just download, I don't know, Arch Linux, Ubuntu, Debian, something like that, and just, it works. We're not at that stage. You still need the custom patches that are done by the project. But things are slowly getting there. Now, here's the problem. When configuring a macho boot object, we now get dropped into an environment where Apple's SPTM is running in GL2, and we're supposed to talk to it from EL2 with MMU already enabled to set up page tables. Now, there's a few terms in here which probably need to be defined to make that sentence make literally any sense. Let's start with SPTM. This is part of Apple's OS integrity stack. This is alongside a number of other features. We just care about this one here. Secure Page Table Monitor, otherwise known as SPTM. This alongside the Trusted Execution Monitor. One other thing is that page table part. What is a page table? This is a mapping between the virtual memory address space and the physical memory address space. Why that is the thing we do outside of the scope of this video, I guess I can leave the Wikipedia page on page tables linked down below if you want to go and read it. Just know that's what it means. Secure page table and trusted execution monitor on iOS, iPadOS, macOS, and visionOS are designed to work together to help protect page tables for both user and kernel processes against modification, even when attackers have kernel write capabilities and can bypass control flow protections. SPTM does this by utilizing a higher privilege level than the kernel and utilizing lower privilege TXM to enforce the policies that govern code execution. This system is designed so that a TXM compromise doesn't automatically translate to a SPTM bypass due to this privilege separation and the governing of trust between them. Now, the MMU, this is a pretty standard thing. I mentioned before that a page table is the mappings between physical memory address space and the virtual memory address space. The MMU basically is what translates the requests between those two address spaces. Now, EL2 and GL2 was quite a bit harder to find. Luckily, a few years back, Sven Peter wrote a blog post explaining some of the Apple Silicon memory stuff, and it does define these. On ARM, the CPU runs in what is called exception levels. If you're familiar with x86, these things are called rings instead. EL0 is user space where applications run. EL1 is usually where the kernel itself runs, and EL2 is where a hypervisor runs. There's also EL3 for firmware or trust zone, but the M1 doesn't have that level. This was back when I believe the M1 was the only version of the Apple Silicon. And remember, EL2 is the one that they want. Now, as for GL2, this is mentioned a bit further down. Now, it's used a few times throughout the post. I believe it is right here. Apple Silicon has two secret features that work hand in hand as an additional mitigation against attacks. GXF introduces lateral exception levels called GL1 and GL2, which use the same page tables as the corresponding EL, but with different page permissions. So reading that once again, when configuring a MuchaBoot object, we now get dropped into an environment where Apple's SPTM is running in GL2, and we are supposed to talk to it from EL2 with MMU already enabled to set up page tables. Moving on from that, this neither works for Linux nor for running XNU under our hypervisor to reverse engineer the new hardware. Now, what is XNU? This is an acronym for X is not Unix, which you may know better as the Darwin OS kernel. Now, a lot of people don't realize this, but Apple at its very core, even though what they produce to the consumer is not open source, the very core of their products is. XNU is licensed under a weird license, the Apple Public Source License, but it is an open source license. Same with Darwin OS, and they used to actually have Darwin OS as like a separate thing you could use, and then kind of just stopped doing that. But this is the base kernel and base operating system for macOS, iOS, watchOS, iPadOS, tvOS, every other operating system that Apple currently does and is likely going to do long into the future. Even if Apple corporate don't care about open source and the Apple engineers don't tend to develop things in an open source way, the way they actually release things is every version they just release the new version, it's clear that at least in some fashion, Apple at least traditionally and has just kind of held on to that, do in some way care about open source. When configuring a raw boot object, we are dropped into EL2 with GL2 and most all Apple specific extensions disabled. This is totally fine for Linux, if you get Linux working on the hardware, but we can't run XNU under our hypervisor that we use to reverse engineer the hardware in this state. So they use XNU, the Apple kernel, as a way to probe at things and work out how it works so they can get it working over on Linux. This also seems to be broken for 50.2 or later right now, probably because it wasn't tested very well. Now, in response to this, there was a question. Does this mean you have to fall back to reverse engineering / kernel auditing, or is there a path for Mini to function as normal? I guess it is too early to say, but would certainly prefer the hypervisor path. Keep up the good work and community progress. An alternative would be to hijack XNU's exception handlers and page table code and patch the tracing in there. We'll see. Now, whilst this certainly is a roadblock for the project, I have absolutely no doubt that the project is going to pull through this problem because at least so far, nothing has stopped them. And I don't see any reason to say, ah, the project's just gonna die because of some problem that comes up reverse engineering. The entire project has been a problem from the start. That's kind of what they expected to get themselves into. But I do want to address the current state of the Asahi Linux naysayers. The Asahi Linux is gonna fail, whatever you want to call it. The people who just, even though every step of the way they've progressed, still think the project is just gonna die. Firstly, there is this reply to the comment from Sven. I'm sad to call it, but without Hector, I predict the semi-slow death of this project now. M4 being the first proper roadblock. Not all of the proper roadblocks they've had before that they've certainly overcome already. M1 and M2 still being a focus of development when M3 has been out for a while, and M4 just released. I think the project is simply drowning in too many to-dos and can't keep up. I hope I'm wrong, I'm not a developer, so I don't know, just a gut feeling. Hector was obviously a very big part of the project, but I think people just forget how many others are involved at this point. Others who are very skilled developers who have progressed past these roadblocks by themselves. This isn't a one-person project. Like, I know that there are people who are very public with the project, who are kind of the faces of it, but that's not the way it's been for a very long time now, and at least from what I can see, nothing is indicating that just because Hector is not the project lead is just gonna die. These are people who want to make this happen themselves and seem to have the knowledge and talent to make it happen. Secondly, I want to address some comments from over on everybody's favorite FOSS, favorite Linux website with near zero moderation. Of course, I'm talking about Pharonix. Well, stop buying MacBooks to run Linux. Support companies that give a damn instead. Fair point. I understand that. Yeah, so much effort to whip a dead horse. In my honest opinion, all this effort and money could cover customizing a distribution to look and feel like macOS. Feeling like macOS is not the point. Why do they want to buy this shit hardware? So much talented dev time wasted on a stupid idea. So, I think a lot of people misunderstand the point of the project. Asahi Linux has never been about supporting Apple hardware at the pace that Apple is supporting it. That's just not viable when you're a fairly small-scale project. But what people want isn't a macOS-like experience. You can configure things to be like macOS. What they want is access to Linux on these really powerful ARM desktop chips, which, yes, there are other ARM options out there, but Apple has made them relatively accessible. Yes, Apple hardware is expensive, but in the context of ARM hardware, it's pretty powerful for the price you get. As for the hardware being bad, the same can kind of be said for projects like TrUltrabook, which is installing Linux natively on Chromebooks. Yes, a lot of Chromebooks are really bad and are just throwaway devices you get from a school. But at the same time, a lot of these devices are really, really cool. And I wouldn't want to tell someone to, you know, not go and make a project that they want to go and make, right? Like, they, in many cases, are hobbyists who are just making a project that they want to make. They're not being paid to work on the thing you want them to work on. You could say, oh, this is a waste of developer effort, but it's their developer effort for their free time, so they're going to spend it on what they want to spend it on. And not having Linux on these devices isn't going to slow down the sales. If Linux is never supported on Apple Silicon, Apple people are going to keep buying Apple devices. But what it does do is when these devices go EOL, same with TrUltrabook here as well, when these devices go EOL, it gives people the ability to purchase these devices and keep them out of e-waste for at least a little bit longer. But what do you think? What are your thoughts on the Asahi Linux project? Do you think it's cool? Like, I don't use Apple Silicon devices, but I can appreciate what they're trying to do here. I don't know. Let me know your thoughts down below. If you liked the video, go like the video. If you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, Silly Bear Pay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and... Penguin.